Hi everyone and welcome to this video. For today, I have two machines here with me which are very similar. These are the HP Prodesk 600 G4 and its successor, the G5. During this video, I will take a look at these machines and their specifications, do a complete disassembly, followed by a reassembly and an upgrade of the memory. If everything still works as expected after that, I will also perform some benchmarks to have a good idea how the performance is. Initially, I plan to do two separate videos of these machines, but as they are so similar, it doesn't make a lot of sense. The Prodesk 600 G4 was released in the second quarter of 2018 and came with 8th generation Intel Core CPUs and got equipped with the Intel Q370S chipset. Its successor, the G5, comes with that exact same chipset. It was released more than a year later, but the only noticeable difference is that it got equipped with 9th generation Intel Core CPUs instead. And as you can see, when I put both of these machines together as well, physically, there is no way to distinguish these from each other apart from the CPU generation mentioned on the sticker. Both machines have the same set of connections on the outside and exactly the same layout on the inside. So rather than repeating things in two separate videos, I will focus mainly on the Prodesk 600 G5. All the information and steps for disassembly, reassembly and upgrades can be applied to the G4 as well. Before taking a better look at the machine, although it is in quite good condition, I did a quick cleaning session where I removed all the buildup dust from the inside. And wiped away any dirt on the outside. That's always more nice to work on. Now that's done, let's have a good look at this PC. The design, which HP has been using for quite some years now, starts to be slightly outdated, but nothing too bad. Just sober and businesslike, without being too boring. All in all, it gives a trustable and decent impression, if you ask me. In terms of connectivity, we have the power button here on the right, an audio connector, 4 USB Type-A ports, a USB Type-C port, room for an optional SD card reader, and the same for a slim DVD drive. On the back, starting from the right, we can see the power supply and its connector, 6 more USB Type-A ports, RG45 for network, optional VGA port, 2x display port and audio. To get inside and open up the case, you need to slide the black lever to the right and then pull the metal top cover backwards so it can be removed. Inside, we can see the 180 watt power supply, the CPU fan and drive tray, which is actually empty here, as we only have an M2 NVMe drive installed directly on the motherboard. To get that drive cage out, we first need to remove the front cover by unclipping it and tilting it forward. Then we can press the small button on the right here to release that drive cage. As you can see, there is room in there for a 3.5 inch drive and also for that optional slim DVD drive. Another small metal piece is installed in front of the machine and it can simply be pulled out. Under there, we can see that NVMe drive, which I mentioned, and we also see the 2 4GB memory DIMMs, which are currently installed. I'll upgrade these two by adding another 2 modules of 4GB, so we can get to a total of 16. But let's first continue with the disassembly and get the currently installed modules out instead. Then, we can also remove that M2 NVMe drive by loosening the tiny screw that is keeping it in place. As you can see, this is a bit of a strange drive as it clearly is a smaller drive mounted on a larger PCB. First time that I see something like that actually, but I guess it works fine. Let's disconnect the power supply now. First the power input in front, then the one next to the CPU, and the power command connector. Finally, we can also disconnect the power output for SATA drives, which runs through the motherboard in this case. To access the CPU fan, we need to remove the plastic cover first, which is there to improve airflow. Once it is removed, we can then disconnect the CPU fan and loosen the 4 screws that keep it in place on top of the CPU. There we go. The thermal paste doesn't look too bad here actually. After cleaning that up, as we will definitely put fresh paste, we can see that this machine is equipped with a Core i5-9500, which is, as expected, part of the 9th generation Intel Core CPUs. The i5-9500, which we have here, has 6 cores and 6 threads and runs at a base frequency of 3 GHz but can boost up to 4.4 GHz. Together with a cache of 9 MB, this should actually perform pretty well, but let's see about that in the benchmarks later. We're almost there. Next step is to remove the 8 screws that keep the motherboard fixed to the case. Then, once that's done, we should be able to gently get the board out. At least if you still disconnect the front speaker, of course. There we go. Now, before looking at all of the components, let's check the power supply quickly. As mentioned before, the PSU installed in here is able to deliver up to 180 watts. So next to powering what is already installed here, there should be enough power budget left for a lower-end, low-profile GPU as well. We have all of the components lined up nicely here, so let's take a look. We have the motherboard, the CPU fan, the CPU itself, the 256GB NVMe drive, and the two pairs of memory that should make a total of 16GB. Before we put everything back together, let's take a look at the motherboard in detail now too. In the center, we can find a CPU socket. Below that, we can see the 4 DDR4 memory slots. Here we have power input, power output for SATA drives, and power COMAT. 3 SATA ports, M.2 slot for NVMe, M.2 for optional Wi-Fi, a connector for that SD card reader, front USB audio and the power button, CPU fan connector, intrusion detection and speaker, PCIe X16 slot and PCIe X4, here's a header for PS2 and a serial port, the extension board with a VGA connector on it, the password reset jumper, CMOS battery and the CMOS reset button. Time to start with our reassembly. So let's put everything back together, starting by reinstalling the motherboard in the case and putting back the screws that hold it firmly there. Now that is done, we can reinsert the CPU as well. Just make sure that this is the left bottom of the CPU, and then we can close the bracket. After a healthy amount of fresh thermal paste, we can also reinstall the CPU fan on top of it. Once that is done, we shouldn't forget to connect it as well. Then it's time for the memory. As we have 4 times the same amount, all slots will be populated. I just make sure to put each pair in the same color of the slots on the motherboard to make sure that we can use dual channel. Next up is the NVMe drive, which still looks funny with this extended PCB. All we have to do is slide it into the M.2 slot and fix it with that tiny screw on the back of it. A little bit off camera, but here I'm just putting back that CPU fan cover, and then we can connect the power supply back to the motherboard. First the power command connector labeled P2, then power input in the front, and eventually also in the back of the case after guiding the cable along that fan duct. Let's also connect the tiny connector of the front speaker. And finally, we can also put back the last cable, the power cord for SATA drives, which is further unused in our build. After this, we can start to close the case by first putting back that metal bracket in the front, followed by reinstalling the drive cage, and putting back the front cover. Now that we have all of that in place, The last thing we need to do is to put back the top cover as well. All right, I connected the reassembled machine to a monitor, keyboard and mouse, so let's power it on and have a look in the BIOS setup, which we can enter by pressing F10 on boot. Here we are. Let's start with system information. In here, we can see the model of our machine, which we already knew, of course, the 16 GB of installed memory and the 256 GB NVMe drive. Scrolling down here shows us the four DIMMs of 4 GB are indeed properly recognized. Other than this, the BIOS setup also offers diagnostic features. Here's the security tab, boot options, and system options. As you can see, more or less anything you would need is configurable in here. Time to exit that BIOS setup and boot into Windows 11 now, for which I did a clean install before. Before going any further, let me first make sure to install all available Windows and driver updates. After rebooting, this also updates the BIOS and other firmware. Always nice to see that this goes very fluent and that we can easily take benefit of any fixes or improvements in these newer versions. Alright, after quite some waiting, all Windows, driver and firmware updates are finally installed, as you can see. Let's take a look at System About now first. Here we can see more or less the same information as we could see in the BIOS setup. Our Core i5-9500 with 16 GB of memory. Task Manager can show us some more details about that hardware. For the CPU, we can indeed see the 6 cores as we saw earlier, and also that cache. For the memory, we can indeed see a total of 16 GB, which consists of 4 modules. We also see the model of NVMe SSD, network device and integrated GPU. Let's test the performance now by first running the CPU benchmark in Geekbench 6. The results show us 1541 for single core and 5553 for multi-core. Comparing this with earlier tested machines like the Optiplex 5070 with the same CPU shows us a slightly lower score, but well within the expected variance, I would say. Let's also run the GPU test in Geekbench. Honestly, I don't expect a lot from that as we don't even have a dedicated GPU in this machine, but I'm curious to see how the integrated graphics actually would perform. Okay, 5536, that is pretty low. Compared to that same Optiplex 5070 with the same CPU, it's a bit higher here, not sure why, but in any case, it's still very low and even less than an already low-end GT 1030, for example. Finally, let's also test the performance of the NVMe SSD with AGA system test. Write speed seems to drop the more I write, but read speed is pretty consistent around 1.4 GB per second. Let me run the test a second time to confirm this behavior. As we could see the first time we ran the test, it indeed gets slower the more we write and it drops until around 500 MB per second. So that means that burst writes are pretty fast, but the more you write, the lower speed you get when writing larger pieces of data. In any case, these speeds are not bad at all and the SSD won't be a bottleneck here as far as I can see. That was all I have for the video. As you could see, this small but nice machine still offers pretty decent performance, as long as you don't require too much GPU power, that is. It's a perfect and quiet machine for office tasks, browsing the internet and watching some streaming or movies. In the next video, I'll probably also try to convert this machine into a Hackintosh, so make sure to subscribe if you don't want to miss that. Thank you for watching till the end. If you have any questions about this machine or you want to share your experience with it, happy to see you in the comments. If you have liked this video, I would appreciate a thumbs up, of course. Thanks again for watching and hope to see you back here soon.